نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلله فلا هادي له أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله عليه من ربه أفضل الصلاة والتسليم أما بعد تبسيل قال الإمام ابن القيم رحمه الله تبارك وتعالى في كتابه إغاثة الأحفاد قال فشبه عرض الفتن على القلوب شيئا فشيئا كعرض عيدان الحصير وهي طاقتها شيئا فشيئا وقسم القلوب عند عرضها عليها إلى قسمين. In the hadith of Hudhayfa that was mentioned last week about the subjecting of the hearts and the presentation of the hearts with fitan, with trials and tribulations, with doubts and desires and these sorts of affairs. When Umar radiallahu anhu asked the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam if any of them had heard what the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had said about al-fitan, so they responded in the affirmative, and he said, "Laysa an hadha as'aluk." He said, "I'm not asking you about this." He said, "Fitnatul mar bi ahlihi wa malihi tukafiruhu salatu wa sadaqatu wa siyam." He said, "The fitnah that a person goes through as regards his wealth and his property and one narration, wa jirani and his neighbors, that it is expiated by his fasting and his giving of sadaqah and his praying." He said, "Walakinni as'alu an al-fitani tamuju ka mawj al-bahr." He said, "But I'm asking about the fitna that is going to rage like the waves of the ocean." This comes in a hadith of Abdullah ibn Amr. Another hadith of Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, تجي الفتن فيرقق بعضها بعضا. A fitna is going to come, and every time it comes it will make what came before it seem like the shurah of the hadith. And those that explain the hadith, they said that it is like a person that is floating in the middle of the ocean, and a wave comes. تجي الفتن, the hadith it says, تجي الفتن فيقول المؤمن هذه مهلكتي. When the fitna comes, the believer, he sees it approaching. And the believer, he doesn't get hit by the fitna and then say, "Oh, that was a fitna." He sees it coming. تجي الفتن, fitna will be approaching. فيقول المؤمن, and the believer, he will say, هذه مهلكتي, this is going to destroy me. This one is going to destroy me. He's always afraid he's going to be destroyed by trials and tribulations. وَتَجِيُ الْفِتَنْ فَيَقُولُ الْمُؤْمِنُ هَذِهِ هَذِهِ. And every time it comes, they'll say the same thing. This is it, this is it. The scholars, they explain, and he has comes in the hadith where Umar, he said, تَمُوجُ كَمَوْجِ الْبَحْرِ. It's going to pulsate like the waves of the ocean. If a person is upon a board in the middle of the ocean, as comes in the statement of مُوَرَّقَ الْعَجَلِ رَحِمُ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى from the Tabi Tabi'een. He said, "La a'rifu lil-mu'mini mathalan asdaq min rajulin mu'alliqun bil-khashab fil-bahr yaqulu rabbi rabbi la'allahu an yujiyahu." He said, "I don't know of a parable that is more true for the believer than a man who is in the middle of the ocean floating upon a board saying, 'Rabbi Rabbi, O my Lord, O my Lord,' hoping that perhaps Allah may save him. And the fitna comes, beware that it's going to destroy him. It's going to be like that. Every time it comes, يُرَقِّقُ بَعْضُهَا بَعْضًا. Every time it comes, it's going to make the one that came before it seem like it was light. It's like a person in the middle of the ocean, a wave comes, woo, here it comes. It's about to take me out. He makes it past that one, right? And right after that one is an even bigger one. And right after that one is an even bigger one. And right after that one is an even bigger one. This is the reality of fitna. It comes in the hadith of Anas ibn Malik, collected in Kitab al-I'tisam of al-Imam al-Bukhari, rahimahullah ta'ala, shakaw ilayhi al-Hajjaj ibn Yusuf. They complained to Anas ibn Malik about Hajjaj ibn Yusuf, al-Thaqafi, the deputy of Marwan ibn Hakim, and a man who had been putting the Muslims, the rulers, the righteous and the unrighteous alike to the sword out of a quest and a thirst for power. So they complained to Anas ibn Malik, who is still alive, about the fitna of Hajjaj ibn Yusuf al-Thaqafi. And he said, مَا مِنْ عَامٍ إِلَّا وَالَّذِي بَعْدَهُ شَرٌ مِنْهُ حَتَّى تَلْقَوْ رَبَّكُمْ ثُمَّ قَالَ سَمِعْتُ هَذَا مِنْ نَبِيِّكُمْ. So it's not a year that passes except the one that comes after will be worse than it until you meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And I heard that from your Prophet. So this is the reality of the affair. The fitna comes. The fitna next year is going to be more severe. The fitna of the next year is going to be more severe. It doesn't cause a believer to have another nadratun sawdawiya, to have a pessimistic, dark outlook upon his life, so on and so forth. But rather, and he takes the opportunity for the good. This comes in the hadith, badiru bil amal fitanan ka qita'i layl al muzlim. And the Prophet foretold that fitna is going to descend and fall upon the earth like pieces of darkness falling upon me, falling out of the sky onto the surface of the earth. And before he mentioned that, he said, Badiru bil amal. He said, rush to do good deeds. Rush to do good deeds. To the point that some of the scholars, they explain some of the narrations about taqarub al-zaman, the time will get shorter, time will pass faster, so on and so forth. A different tafsirat, different explanations that are given by the scholars, what is meant by the time will pass faster. And one of the explanations that is given, that is a true explanation, and a valid explanation, because we know that actually at the time of the Dajjal, there will be days that will be like shatter, that will be like a flashing, like a spark, like a flickering flame. Right? The days will pass, imagine the sun, like that, right? So time will actually pass, there will be days that are like that. And وَسَائِرُ أَيَامِهِ كَشَرَرْ there will be some days that are like shatter, and the rest of the days will be like your days. طيب. But one of the explanations that is given by the scholars about the quick passing of time and what it means, تَقَارُبُ الزَّمَانِ, is that people will not get benefit from their time. And that it will take the people, in a year, would it normally take them an hour or a day or a month to accomplish of good deeds. The nature of fitna is that fitna تُعَوِّقُ الْخَيْرَاتِ, it obstructs and blocks a person from doing a lot of good. So a person, they have to capitalize upon certain opportunities in the year, like Ramadan, in the days of the Hijjah, certain opportunities in the day, like the last third of the night, and certain types of deeds, like the dhikr of Allah, and seeking beneficial knowledge, that, and you have less of an effort, but more of a blessing and more of a benefit. Whatever the case of Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam in the hadith of Hudhaifa, he foretold what would occur when the hearts are presented with fitna. And he compared this presentation of fitna little by little to the weaving of a straw mat, stick after stick in quick succession. He said, وَقَسَّمَ الْقُرُوبَ أَنْ عَرْضِهَا عَلَيْهَا إِلَىٰ قِسْمَيْنِ. He said, and when the hearts are presented with fitna, the Prophet ﷺ said there will become two types of hearts. He said, the type of heart first, that when it is presented with fitna, أُشْرِبَهَا, and it will become impregnated with the fitna. It will absorb it like a sponge. كَمَا يَشْرَبْ أَسِفْنْجْ الْمَاء. It's a difficult word to say. It's like a sponge will absorb the water. فَتُنْكَتُ فِيهِ نُكْتَةٌ سَوْدَاءَ, and thereupon it will be marked with a black mark. And فَلَا يَزَالُ يُشْرَبُ كُلُّ فِجْنَةٍ تُعْرَضُ عَلَيْهِ, and it will keep absorbing every fitna that it is, that is presented to it. حَتَّى يَصْوَدَّ وَيَنْتَكِسْ, until it becomes pitch black and collapses. وَهُوَ مَعْنَ قَوْلِهِ كَالْكُوزِ مُجَخِّيَةِ. He said this is what is meant in the hadith, كَالْكُوزِ مُجَخِّيَةِ, a مَكْبُوبَ مَنْكُوزَ, like an upturned vessel that cannot contain anything. And he meaning that it is knocked over. فَإِذَا سْوَدَّ وَانْتَكَسْ, once it becomes dark and collapses. عُرِضَ لَهُ مِنْ هَاتَيْنَ الْآثَتَيْنِ مَرَضَان خَطِيرَان مُتَرَامِيَان إِلَى الْحَلَاكِ. He said, once this occurs, and there will be two affairs that are very dangerous, that will lead it to its destruction, that I mentioned in the hadith. أَحَدُهُمَا اشْتِبَاهُ الْمَعْرُوفِ عَلَيْهِ بِالْمُنْكَرِ, is that they will confuse right for wrong and good for evil. Person will confuse iman for kufr, sunnah for bid'ah, haq for batil, so on and so forth. They will confuse what is ma'roof to be munkar and a munkar to be ma'roof. فَلَا يَعْرِفُ مَعْرُوفًا وَلَا يُنْكِرُ مُنْكَرًا, as the hadith says, they won't know right from wrong. وَرُبَّمَا اسْتَحْكَمَ فِيهِ هَذَا الْمَرَضِ, he said, to the point that this disease of not being able to know right from wrong will take complete control of the heart. حَتَّى يَعْتَقِدَ الْمَعْرُوفُ مُنْكَرًا وَالْمُنْكَرَ مَعْرُوفًا وَسُنَّةَ بِدْعَةً وَالْبِدْعَةَ سُنَّةً وَالْحَقَّ بَاطِلًا وَالْبَاطِلَ حَقَّ, to the believes that the truth is falsehood and the falsehood is truth, and right is wrong and wrong is right, and the sunnah is innovation and innovation is a sunnah. This is the first thing. It will lose its ability of perception. The functions of the heart, as we'll come to see throughout this book, are two types. They are quwwatul idrak wa quwwatul qasd. The ability of idrak, and yani al-fahm, husn al-fahm, and the ability of perceiving, whether that fahm is hasan or sayyi, whether it's a good understanding or a bad understanding. The heart has the ability to reach, to perceive things. This is the first ability of the heart. The second ability is the ability to intend. The ability to intend. And so everything connected to the function of the heart, the life of the heart, the death of the heart, the sickness of the heart, the health of the heart, goes back to these two things. Its understanding and its intention. What you know and what you want. What you know and what you want. As we say, when people go astray, you say about a person, either they don't know or either they don't care. Either you don't know or either you don't care. There are two realities of people. You don't know or you don't care. I mean, what do you know and what do you want? Because when you know, you have a prioritization now. You know what will benefit you in this world and the hereafter, how to get it. What will harm you in this world and the hereafter, how to avoid it. Now you can prioritize. Right? Your highest priority is to reach the hereafter, to say the salama. Everything in your mindset from the time you enter into Islam until the time that you meet Allah, tabarakwa ta'ala, goes back to that. Goes back to your understanding, and now that you know what will benefit you and what will harm you and how to get it and how to avoid what will harm you and so on and so forth, then you want what will benefit you. You want to stay away from what's going to harm you and so on and so forth. And so this is the reality. And so Ibn Qayyim rahimahullah ta'ala, and he mentions here that when the heart is destroyed by fitna, and a person that says of rejecting the fitna, hating what Allah hates, rejecting what is harmful of shahawat, of desires, and what is destructive of shubuhat, of doubts concerning his religion, and people bringing false interpretation of affairs and principles in his religion. And every time, as comes in the statement of Ali to Kumail ibn Ziyad, he said that they follow every na'iq, rahmukallah, yamiluna ma'a kulli rih. And they follow every na'iq. Every time somebody starts clucking and making noise and carrying about, causing fitna and confusion and so on and so forth, they latch onto these personalities. And we see that. Allah, we see that. And people, they never took any time to study Islam, to learn anything about Islam. And so if somebody falls off the bus, they jump right out the back door with them. Right? So that joker fell off the bus. Oh, really? It's my boy. Get back on the bus, cuz. Come on, you only once in a week. Don't connect yourself to him. Right? من كان منكم مستنًا فليستن بمن قد مات فإن الحيلة تؤمن عليه الفتن. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم وراد عبد الله بن عمر and عبد الله بن مسعود, they said رضي الله عنهما, and whoever of you is to take somebody as your example, let them follow the example and role model of somebody who has died already, who has died upon the sunnah. But verily the person who is still alive is not for your fitna. Right? So the reality of the affair. And people, they latch onto people. And so people, they get caught up and they go right along behind that person, defending them in the batil. And the person, يُجَادِلُ عَنْ batil لَا يَزَالُ فِي سَخَةِ اللَّهِ حَتَّى يَرْجِعَ. This comes in authentic hadith. He will never cease to be under the wrath of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala until he recants and comes back to the truth. So this is what happens. And his conceptualization, and he sees the sunnah to be bidah, the bidah to be sunnah. He sees right to be wrong, wrong to be right. He sees what is beneficial to be harmful and what is harmful to be beneficial. This is the first thing. The second thing, تَحْكِيمُهُ هَوَاهُ عَلَى مَا جَاءَ بِهِ الرَّسُولُ صلى الله عليه وسلم وَانْقِيَادُهُ لِلْهَوَى وَاتِّبَاعُهُ لَهُ. The second thing, as mentioned in this hadith, is that he will judge by his desires. Instead of wanting what Allah wants for him and what Allah has ordered him with, instead of wanting what Allah wants for him, what Allah has ordered him with, and he makes the religion mean what he wants it to mean. He makes the religion mean what he wants it to mean. That goes back to what the second thing in Hawa, al-qasd, his intention. His intention is shifty, shaky, unstable, and he wants to find a way to make the religion bend to conform to his desires. And so he judges what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam came with according to his desires, and he surrenders therefore to his desires and follows his desires. وَقَلْبٌ أَبْيَضْ قَدْ أُشْرِقَ فِيهِ نُورُ الْإِيمَانِ وَأُزْهِرَ فِيهِ مِصْبَاحٌ فَإِذَا عُرِضَتْ عَلَيْهِ الْفِتْنَةُ أَنْكَرَهَا وَكَرِهَهَا فَازْدَادَ نُورُهُ وَإِشْرَاقُهُ وَقُوَّتُهُ. He said to me, second type of heart that is mentioned in the hadith is a heart that is illuminated with the light of faith, and the lantern of faith shines therein. Where is the verse found that mentions that? That faith is like a lantern, a misbah inside of the heart of the person. Surah An-Nur. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said, مَثَلُ نُورِهِ كَمِشْكَاتِ, and his light is like a mishkat. A mishkat is a niche. A person was constructing a wall, and the people that are contractors, right? When you're making like a bathroom or a shower, you put a niche into the wall, right? So you put their soap and their shampoo, so on and so forth, right? The people used to build a niche into the walls to put their lamps, right? It's like a niche. The example of the light of Allah is like a niche, right? A niche, and is a hollowed out part in a wall. Tayyib. The ulama, they say what is meant by the niche is a sadr, is the chest of the believer. Is the chest of the believer. And the example of the light of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, كَمِشْكَاتٍ فِيهَا مِصْبَاح. It has a lamp inside of it, right? It has a lantern, a lamp inside of it. And the misbah is in zujaja, and the lamp is enclosed with glass to protect the flame. So the lamp is al-hidayah, is guidance from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is a person's, these two things that I mentioned here, his correct intention and his correct understanding. This is the reality of his light. And this is al-hidayah. He knows the truth and he wants it. He wants what Allah wants for him. Right? This is the reality of it. Ibn Qayyim, he said, and the glass is his heart. And the glass is his heart. He said, because glass has three qualities that are found in the heart of the believer. which are as-safa'u wal-riqqa wal-salaba. As-safa'u wal-riqqatu wal-salaba. Clarity. My son just came recently, he said he called it the clarity pill. They want you to come and take the clarity pill. Don't you take some clarity pills, cuz? The clarity pill. Hasbunallah, ya akhi. Attaqillah. Ru'ida. As-safa, clarity. Wal-riqqa, delicacy. Was-salaba, and firmness. These are three qualities that are in glass that are the qualities of the heart of the believer. As-safa'u, wal-riqqa, was-salaba. Clarity, gentleness, or delicacy, and salaba, firmness. So the heart of the believer is upon clarity, right? According to its understanding, it's upon clarity, right? According to what is burning inside of it, that light, that lamp, that hidayah, as long as he's taken from authentic sources, right? And he's not hard to belayel, as they say. I mean, the person who goes and gets firewood at night to light his fire, the person that gets fired in at night, firewood at night, say he goes out and he doesn't have a lamp, right? And he goes and grabs a snake, grabs a turd, grabs everything that you can imagine. He comes back, he says, what's in the bag? I'm gonna throw it in the fire. He got bones, got some snakes, he got some dried up fecal matter, all kinds of stuff, right? A fire is going to do something amazing. When he throws that stuff in the fire, it's gonna be sizzling and popping and smoking and all kinds of stuff, right? He's gonna have to run out the cave or the tent or wherever he's at, or the cabin or whatever. So long as his source, and his mustar talaqi, the source of where he takes his religion from, is clear and authentic, then that light is going to be bright inside of his chest, and he's going to have the safa. He's going to have this clarity, and he's going to have delicacy in his proper place, and he's going to have harshness in his proper place. He's going to love for Allah, and he's going to hate for Allah, and he's going to give what he gives for Allah and withhold what he holds for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. مَنْ أَحَبَّ فِي اللَّهِ وَأَبْغَضَ فِي اللَّهِ وَمَنَعَ لِلَّهِ وَعَاطَ لِلَّهِ وَمَنَعَ لِلَّهِ فَقَدْ اسْتَكْمَلَ الْإِيمَانِ. The hadith says, whoever loves for Allah, hates for Allah, gives for Allah, withholds for Allah, then he has completed his faith. So he has clarity, and he has al-wala'u wal-bara'. As we mentioned before, this is from the muqtadiyat of the shahadatain. So it is required by the shahadatain. La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah. And we mentioned last week that the statement La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah, that goes back to those two things that we mentioned, which are the person's understanding and the person's intention. The person's understanding is based upon what came, the risala, the message of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And his intention is what? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's the reality of La ilaha illallah. Nothing deserves to be intended with worship other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's the reality of the affair. And so this is the basis of the life of his heart, the pristineness of his heart, so on and so forth. So his heart will be upon brightness, as opposed to the second heart, or the first heart that we just mentioned. The heart, it has hardness, right? It has firmness, but the firmness is outside of its proper place. كَالْكُزِ مُجَخِيَ. And it's like an upturned vessel that can't contain anything. So it's firm, it's knocked over, aswad murbadan, and he aswad, and he pitch black with a grayish hue. His heart is completely dead, hard. And his heart is hard and shriveled up. Upturned, it can't contain anything. Nothing is in his heart. لَا يَعْرِفُ مَعْرُوفًا وَلَا يُنْكِرُ مُنْكَرًا إِلَّا مَا أُشْرِبَ مِنْ هَوَاهُ. He doesn't know the right from the wrong except for what it takes in of its desires. Ibn Qayyim said, فِي الْفِتَنُ الَّتِي تُعْرَضُ عَنَ الْقُرُوبِ هِيَ أَسْبَابُ مَرَضِهَا. He said, and so the fitna, the different types of trials and calamities and tribulations that are presented to the heart are the causes of his illness. وَهِيَ فِتَنُ الشَّهَوَاتِ وَفِتَنُ الشُّبُحَاتِ. And there are two types of fitna of doubts and the fitna of desires. As we mentioned before, that all the function of the heart goes back to its understanding and going back to its intention. And so the two types of fitna that destroy the heart are doubts and desires. Doubts and harmful desires. وفتن الغي والضلال وفتن المعاصي والبدع وفتن الظلم والجهل. فالأولى توجب فساد القصد والإرادة والثانية توجب فساد العلم والاعتقاد. He said, so it is a fitna of doubts and desires. It's a fitna of any being astray in one's behavior and astray in one's understanding. The fitna of disobedience, which comes from desires, and bid'ah, which comes from shubuhat. وفتن الظلم والجهل. And the fitna of oppression, where a person wants that which is harmful for him, thinking it will bring some benefit for himself or whatever. And the fitna of oppression and jahl, and ignorance. All evil comes from ignorance and oppression. So oppression goes back to his desire, and jahl goes back to his understanding. He says, so the first type, توجب فساد القصد والإرادة. And in the first type of fitna, it causes the person's ambitions and desire to become corrupt. وَثَانِيَ تُوجِبُ فَسَادُ الْعِلْمِ وَالْاَعْتِقَادِ. And the second type of fitna, it causes the person's knowledge and creed and belief to become corrupt. وَقَدْ قَسَّمَ الصُّحَابَةُ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَىٰ عَنْهُمَ الْقُلُوبِ إِلَىٰ أَرْبَعَ. He goes on to say, and he brings an authentic narration from Hudhayfa bin al-Yaman radiyallahu anhu, from the statement of Hudhayfa. The last hadith was from Hudhayfa, but it was the statement of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is the understanding of the Sahaba. So now you have the Sahaba explaining to you, and there was none who knew about fitna better than Hudhayfa from the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to the point that entire books have been gathered and collected about the marriyat of Hudhayfa about al-fitan. And in the narrations of Hudhayfa, his statements and his reports from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam about trials and tribulations that would befall the Ummah. He said the companions divided their hearts into four categories. كَمَا صَحَّ عَنْ حُذَيْفَ ibn al-Yaman. As is authentically reported from Hudhayfa ibn al-Yaman, collected by Abdullah ibn al-Mubarak in Kitab al-Zuhd, an Imam ibn Abi Shaybah, and Abdullah ibn Ahmed in Kitab al-Sunnah, and ibn Jarir al-Tabari in his Tafsir, and Abu Nu'aym in Hilyat al-Awliya. Hudhayfa radiallahu anhu said, al-qulubu arba'a. He said there are four types of hearts. Qalbun ajrad, fihi sirajun muzahharu, fadharika qalbun mu'min. He said there is a heart that is pure, and it has a lantern, it has a lamp that is shining therein. That is the heart of the believer. وَقَلْبٌ أَغْلَفُ فَذَارِكَ قَلْبُ الْكَافِرُ. And there is a heart that is closed and sealed. That is the heart of the disbeliever. وَقَلْبٌ مَنْكُوسٌ. And a heart that is flipped upside down. فَذَارِكَ قَلْبُ الْمُنَافِقُ. And that is the heart of a munafiq. عَرَفَ ثُمَّ أَنْكَرُ وَأَبَصَرَ ثُمَّ عَمِيَ. He said he knew what was correct and then rejected it. And he saw the truth and chose to be blind. وَقَلْبٌ تَمُدُّهُ مَادَّتَانِ. He said, and there is a fourth type of heart that has two things that are fueling it. Two things that are fueling it. مَادَّةُ إِيمَان وَمَادَّةُ نِفَاق. And it is fueled by Iman and it is fueled by Nifaq. It has both Iman and Nifaq within it. Has Iman and hypocrisy within it. And he has Iman and hypocrisy. And hypocrisy is إظهار الخير مع إبطان الشر. And he is a person exhibits the good, portrays, displays the good, while they are concealing evil within themselves. And he has belief and he has Nifaq within him. وَهُوَ لِمَا غَلِبَ عَلَيْهِ مِنْهُمَا. And whatever is the predominant state of his heart, whether it is Iman and Nifaq, will eventually take over his heart. And he explains the statement. He said, فَقَوْلُهُ قَلْبٌ أَجْرَدٍ. This is from the blessings of Allah that we have, as was mentioned before, that we have access to what is in the Book of Allah and the Sunnah of the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the statements of the Salaf as regards any that which only Allah can see, which is what's going on inside of the hearts of mankind. Only Allah can see what's going on inside of people's hearts. Ibn al-Qayyim, he began in the introductory khutbah, the sermon, the introductory pages of the book, mentioning that this is something that we praise Allah for, that Allah has given us an opportunity to look at that which only He can see, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Meaning to be able to know about what is occurring in the hearts of mankind. And these are some things you can know, some things you can understand, but in general, the details of these affairs is something that is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then on top of that, you have the statement of Al-Imam Ibn Qayyim rahimahullah ta'ala, explaining to you these ahadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, opening them up for you with the keys of knowledge, and explaining to you in detail what they mean, and these statements of the Salaf al-Salih. He says, so the statement of Hudhayfa, قَلْبٌ أَجْرَدْ أَيْ مُتَجَرِّدْ مِمَّا سِوَى اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ صلى الله عليه وسلم. The heart that is أجرد is the heart that has تجريد, and the heart that is free of attachment to anything besides Allah and His Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم. The heart that is devoted to nothing but Allah and His Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم. فَقَدْ تَجَرَّدَ وَسَلِمَ مِمَّا سِوَى الْحَقِّ. So the heart has devoted itself and freed itself of everything besides the truth. وَفِيهِ سِرَاجٌ يُزَحَّرُ أَوْ يُزْحَرُ وَهُوَ مُصْبَحُ الْإِيمَانِ. He said, and it has a lantern that is shining within. He said, and it is the lantern of faith. فَأَشَارَ بِتَجَرُّدِهِ إِلَى سَلَامَتِهِ مِنْ شُبُهَاتِ الْبَاطِلِ وَشَهَوَاتِ الْغَيِّ. He said, and so Hudhayfa, he indicated by saying that the heart, and he has a state of tajarrud, and that the heart has stripped off everything of devotion besides devotion to Allah and His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, devotion to the truth. He has indicated here that the heart is free of the shubuhat al-batil, and the doubts of falsehood, wa shahawat al-ghayy, and the harmful desires and lust. وبحصول السراج فيه إلى إشراقه واستنارته بنور العلم والإيمان. And then by saying that it has a lantern shining within it, a lamp shining within it, and he's showing that it has within it, that the reason that it is the way that it is it has the light of knowledge and faith. And no person is going to be able to progress in their religion without knowledge. And a person who thinks and that they're going to be able to make strides in their religion, progress as an individual, and be able to raise their family without taking any type of time to learn their religion and memorize and review and so on and so forth, that person is fooling themselves. As the Salaf used to say, مَنْ لَا يَصْبِرْ عَلَى ظُلِّ الْتَعَلُّمِ سَعَةً يَصْبِرُ يَتَصَبَّرْ ظُلَّ الْجَهْلِ طُولَ عُمْرِهِ. He's a person who isn't patient enough to take a short period of time off from their schedule to learn their religion. The person who isn't patient enough to go through the dhul, any of the humiliation. A person may be embarrassed that they don't know certain things. They hear things they should have known a long time ago, should have learned a long time ago. And they feel that I'm this old, or I've been Muslim this long, or I've been on the Sunnah this long, or I've been on Salafiyya for this long, or I've been sitting in classes for this long, but I still really don't know a whole lot. And they say that it's degrading to them. They feel embarrassed. Some people are like that. They have wahsha. They come to the halaqatul ilm, and they come to the circles of dhikr, the circles of remembrance, the circles of learning, and they feel embarrassed. They feel embarrassed. They shouldn't feel embarrassed for two reasons. One, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, hum qawmu لا يشقى بهم جليسهم. That there are people that no one who is sitting with them will be in a state of misery. No one that is with them will be ruined. Any people, they come to sit in the classes and they're not even paying attention, inshallah the rahmah will still descend upon them. If they're not even paying attention, inshallah the rahmah will still descend upon them. Second, the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, من سرك طريقا what? يلتمس فيه علما. من سلك طريقا, and whoever سلك traverses, walks upon a tariq, a pathway, يلتمس فيه علما. يلتمس, التماس is intending, making an effort to get knowledge thereby. Meaning even if he doesn't learn, right? Even if he doesn't learn what he endeavored to learn, what he set out to try to learn, the fact that he made that effort is enough. سهل الله به له به طريقا إلى الجنة. that Allah will make easy for him the path to Jannah, just for making the effort. He may not get everything, he may not get much, right? They say, they make a joke, they say one time there was a brother that was sitting on the wall sleeping. Nabawi Sahimullah Ta'ala was teaching a class, and the brothers, they said, you know, they show the guy like he was sleeping, like they point at the guy like, you know, like he's sleeping. Say Abu Way said he probably learned more than all of y'all. Every person, they come out and they make an intention. You know, sometimes, alhamdulillah, we have elders, older people that come to the class, and they may have dietary issues or health issues that cause them to, you know, be any narcoleptic shway. A little bit narcoleptic, right? Falling asleep on a cue, so on and so forth. Alhamdulillah, the person that just comes out and makes an effort, inshallah, they're going to get some benefit. Inshallah, they're going to get some benefit. So a person should never feel like that. But the Salaf used to say that the person who isn't patient enough to deal with the humiliation of learning for a short period of time will have to live the entirety of his life with the humiliation of ignorance. He will have to live his entire life with the humiliation of ignorance. So this is a reality. And a person, as is mentioned in the statement, and as is found all through the Book of Allah and the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and that the cause of the life of the heart of a person, the correction of their understanding, the correction of their intention, so on and so forth, the correction of their ambitions, their life plan, and the methodology they're taking, everything of the sort, it comes through knowledge. وَأَشَارَ بِالْقَلْبِ الْأَغْلَفِ إِلَى قَلْبِ الْكَافِرِ. Hudhayfa, he went on to indicate by saying, and a heart that is aghlaf, and a heart that is closed, and the heart of a disbeliever. لِأَنَّهُ دَاخِلٌ فِي غِيْرَاتِهِ وَهِشَائِهِ فَلَا يَسِلُ إِلَيْهِ نُورُ الْعِلْمِ وَالْإِيمَانِ. The light of knowledge and faith has not reached it. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said about the Yahud, وَقَالُوا قُلُوبُنَا غُلْفٌ. And they said that our hearts are closed and sealed. وَهُوَ جَمْلُ أَغْلَفْ وَهُوَ الدَّاخِلُ فِي غِيْلَاتِهِ كَقُفْلٍ وَأَقْفَلْ وَهَذِهِ الْغِشَاوَةِ هِيَ الْأَكِنَّةُ الَّتِي ضَرَبَهَا اللَّهُ تَعَالَى عَلَى قُلُوبِهِمْ عُقُوبَةً لَهُمْ عَلَى رَدِّ الْحَقِّ وَتَكَبُّرِ عَنْ قَبْلِهِ. He said, and it is a seal that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has struck their hearts with as a punishment for them for rejecting the truth and being too arrogant to accept it. وَهِيَ أَكِنَّةٌ عَلَى الْقُلُوبِ وَوَقْرٌ فِي الْأَسْمَعِ وَعَمَّنْ فِي الْأَبْصَارِ. He said, it is a seal over the heart, a seal over the hearing, and a seal over the eyes. And a person, no matter what they see, no matter what they hear, and no matter what they think about, they won't reach the truth. Because they rejected the truth, they turned their backs on the truth, they don't want the truth, so on and so forth. And so Allah has sealed their hearing, their hearing, their sight, and their hearts. وَهِيَ الْحِجَابُ الْمَسْتُورُ عَنِ الْعُيُونِ فِي قَوْلِهِ تَعَالَى. He said, and it is the veil that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has placed over the eyes, as he mentioned subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَإِذَا قَرَأْتَ الْقُرْآنَ جَعَلْنَا بَيْنَكَ وَبَيْنَ الَّذِينَ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ بِالْآخِرَةِ حِجَابًا مَسْتُورًا وَجَعَلْنَا عَلَى قُلُوبِهِمْ أَكِنَّةً أَن يَفْقَهُوهُ وَفِي آذَانِهِمْ وَقْرًا. Allah says in Surah Al-Isra, a surah that is entirely about guidance, He says that when you recite the Quran to them, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that we have placed between you and between those who do not believe in the hereafter, hijaban mastura, a veil to obstruct them. وَجَعَلْنَا عَلَى قُلُوبِهِمْ أَكِنَّةً. And we have placed a seal over their hearts, أَن يَفْقَهُوهُ وَفِي آذَانِهِمْ وَقَرًا, lest that they understand it, and a sealing over their hearing, from the justice of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. فَإِذَا ذُكِرَ لِهَذِهِ الْقُلُوبِ تَجْرِيدُ التَّوْحِيدِ وَتَجْرِيدُ الْمُتَابَعَةِ وَلَّ أَصْحَابُهَا عَلَىٰ أَدْبَارِهِ النُّفُورَ. And when, and the sign that these hearts are destroyed is that when you mention to these hearts any devotion to following the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and devotion to making worship sincerely for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone with our partners, وَلَّ أَصْحَابُهَا عَلَىٰ أَدْبَارِهِ النُّفُورَ, then those people who have hearts that are like that, they turn back on their heels and they flee. وأشار بالقلب المنكوس وهو المكبوب إلى قلب المنافق. And the heart that is upturned, the heart that is knocked over and upturned, upside down, he is the heart of the munafiq, and the heart of the hypocrite. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said, فَمَا لَكُمْ فِي الْمُنَافِقِينَ فِيَاتَيْنُ وَاللَّهُ أَرْكَسَهُمْ بِمَا كَسَبُوا. He says, so let there not be two groups of people with two different viewpoints from amongst you about the munafiqeen. While Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala أَرْكَسَهُمْ بِمَا كَسَبُوا has caused them to collapse and fall over because of what they have earned. And because of what they have earned, because of the actions that they did in opposition to the truth and wanting the religion to fail, as the scholars, they say that major nifaq is rejecting the Prophet or anything that he came with, hating the Prophet or anything that he came with, loving to see the religion of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam weak in the earth, or hating to see the religion of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam uppermost in the earth. Sittatu anwa, six categories. The people who fell into that reject the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam while saying they believe in Ma'awali, or reject anything that he came with, hated the Prophet or anything that he came with, love to see the religion of the Prophet ﷺ to be weak, or hated to see the religion of the Prophet ﷺ to be victorious in the earth. Allah said, وَاللَّهُ أَرْكَسَهُمْ بِمَا كَسَبُوا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala أَرْكَسَهُمْ, he caused them to collapse and topple over, meaning their hearts. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, he caused their hearts to fall over and collapse and be ruined because of what they had earned. أَيْنَ كَسَهُمْ وَرَدَّهُمْ فِي الْبَاطِلِ الَّذِي كَانُوا فِيهِ بِسَبَبِ كَسَبِهِمْ وَعَمَالِهِمْ. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he returned them back to the falsehood that they had were previously engaged in before claiming to be Muslim, because of the fact that they had incurred upon themselves these actions that were batila, that were falsehood. فَهَذَا شَرُّ الْقُلُوبُ وَأَخْبَثُهَا. He said, and out of the hearts, out of all of these four types of hearts, this is the most filthy and despicable and evil of hearts. فَإِنَّهُ يَعْتَقِدُ الْبَاطِلَ حَقَّ وَيُوَالِي أَصْحَابَهُ. But daily it believes the falsehood to be truth, and it makes its wala based upon that, and it supports the people of falsehood. وَالْحَقَّ بَاطِلًا وَيُعَادِي أَهْلَهُ. Well, and at the same time it believes the truth to be falsehood and has hostility and animosity towards the people of the truth. وَاللَّهُ الْمُسْتَعَانِ. وَأَشَارَ بِالْقَلْبِ الَّذِي لَهُ مَادَّتَانِ إِلَى الْقَلْبِ الَّذِي لَمْ يَتَمَكَّنْ فِيهِ الْإِيمَانِ. And he indicated, رضي الله عنه, حذيفة indicated by saying the heart that has two things that are supplying it, are fueling it. So the heart that Iman is not firm in. وَلَمْ يُزْهَرُ فِيهِ سِرَاجُهُ. And that the lamp of faith is not bright therein. That the lamp of faith is not bright therein. It flickers. It flickers. حيث لم يتجر للحق المحض الذي بعث الله به رسوله. Inasmuch as that has not devoted itself to the pure truth that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent the messenger with. صلى الله عليه وسلم. بل فيه مادة منه ومادة من خلافه. But rather, it has a portion of the truth and a portion of falsehood, a portion of that which opposes the truth. It has some sunnah with it, it has some bid'ah with it, it has some iman with it, it has some kufriyat with it, it has some tawheed with it, it has some inclinations to shirk within it. He said it has some of this and it has the khilaf, it has that which opposes the truth. فَتَارَةً يَكُونُ الْكُفْرِ أَقْرَ مِنْهُ لِلْإِيمَانِ. And sometimes a person, he will find his heart is closer to kufr than iman. He will find his heart is closer to kufr than iman. وَتَارَةً يَكُولُ لِلْإِيمَانِ أَقْرَبْ مِنْهُ لِلْكُفْرِ. And sometimes he will find that he is closer to iman than kufr. وَالْحُكْمُ لِلْغَالِبِ. And whatever overwhelms his heart and is what is found the most in his heart will end up being the state of his heart. His kufr, his yani, confusion, his falsehood, his loving falsehood, so on and so forth, will either take him all the way out of it. That's why the ulama, they say, al-bid'a barid al-kufr, wal-ma'asi barid al-kufr, dihliz al-kufr wa shirk, wa munaza'at illahi rububiyyata. Ibn Qayyim, rahimahullah ta'ala, he mentioned the statements of the Salaf in al-da'u wa al-dawa. He said that innovation is barid al-kufr. Innovation is the herald of kufr. The barid is a person that would come to the town and say, everybody, I have an announcement to make, a proclamation. And if something is about to happen, this is about to happen, that's about to happen. The army is about to invade, the king is about to send his dignitaries or whatever it is. They call it the barid, like the mailman of today, the person he brings the news, right? The barid, he's a person that he comes and he's a proclaimer, the town crier, right? So innovation is the town crier of Kufr. It's announcing to everybody, Kufr is on its way, right? Kufr is on its way. And if you adhere to this falsehood, that is dakhil ala deenillahi tabarak wa ta'ala, that has infiltrated the religion of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, that has nothing to do with the religion, that has a chain of narration going back to Iblis, and call it the sunnah, innovation leads people to kufr. Innovation leads people to kufr. Falsehood in general leads people to kufr. Shubuhat and shahawat and sin and disobedience likewise, it leads people to disbelief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And it doesn't by itself, as we know, the creed of Ahl Sunnah, and that sins do not make a person a disbeliever, but they can lead a person to disbelief. As the scholars, they mention in detail, the more a person disobeys Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the more or the less significant Allah becomes in that person's heart. To the point that Allah's religion, Allah's orders, and the worship of Allah, the following of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, one day may be entirely irrelevant and insignificant to him, and he doesn't feel as though he needs his religion anymore. And it's a mentality. It's the reason why he's committing the sins, not the sins itself that may eventually lead him out of the fold of Islam. It's very destructive. فَتَارَةً يَكُنُ لِلْكُفْرِ أَقْرَبْ مِنْهُ لِلْإِيمَانِ. So sometimes he may be closer to kufr than iman, and sometimes he may be closer to iman than kufr. وَالْحُكْمُ لِلْغَالِبِ وَإِلَيْهِ يَرْجِعُ. He said, and the ruling that his heart will take will be whatever is predominant within it, and that which he constantly goes back to and returns back to. And this is the end of the first chapter of إِغَافَةُ الْأَحْبَانِ فِي مَصَائِرِ الشَّيْطَانِ الإمام ابن القيم رحمه الله تعالى. And next week we'll begin inshallah the second chapter, الباب الثاني في ذكر حقيقة مرض القلب, the reality of the sickness of the heart, the reality of the sickness of the heart. So ابن القيم, he laid some groundwork here, some fundamentals, and in that you can identify, you can start to look at yourself as an individual, start to look at the situation of your children, the situation of those people that you keep company with, that you have made your friends and so on and so forth, and say, where are they with these things? And what can we tell about our situation and the situation of the people, so that we can put the medicine in its proper place, and give advice as is needed, wanting the good for the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and understanding therefore, what is the motivating and driving force for the creation, and the fact that the affair of the Tawheed wa Sunnah, Aqeedah and Manhaj is the source for the cure of the heart. That everything from the life of the heart, the strength of the heart, and the health of the heart goes back to a person having a strong Aqeedah and having a strong Manhaj. And you have people who want to take a methodology to correction and rectification and working on the problems of the community and the society, that doesn't begin with this, and that person is fooling themselves and tricking themselves. And this is something that is in the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala has allowed us to gather here at this blessed masjid. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to allow these gatherings to increase and to allow us to benefit from what we hear, make us from those who follow the best of what we hear, and make what we hear hujjatan lana la alayna, and a proof in our favor and not against us. Wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam.